In front of us?
Right in front of us. Over here, right here.
Over the last 12 days, roughly 225 tornadoes have wreaked havoc in the Midwest. Just this week, 82 storms touched down, leaving a path of destruction from eastern Indiana to central Ohio. Several people were killed, dozens injured, and hundreds of homes were destroyed.
Late spring and early summer are considered tornado season. While multiple twisters are common, researchers say that they have not seen a pattern this productive in years. Joining us via Skype to explain that what this is and what's causing these devastating events is meteorologist and storm chaser Quincy Vagell. He joins us now via Skype. Thank you for being here, Quincy.
Thanks. Good to be with you.
So tell me, what's the cause of this at a very kind of basic level?
Well, there's been a very stagnant pattern where you've had this ridge of high pressure across the southeastern United States. And then in the West Coast, you've had a trough of low pressure. And when these two systems come together, you tend to get tornadoes. But what's been unique this year is that the pattern's been so stagnant for about 2 weeks. Literally day after day, you've had just patterns of several tornadoes.
Now, Quincy, you're one of the country's leading experts on this stuff. Can you tell us a little bit more specifically about your work and how you got here and what you do every day?
Well, it's interesting. I got my degree in meteorology back in 2009. I worked in TV for a few years, and believe it or not, I thought that was actually boring for me. I wanted to be out in the field storm chasing. So I've been storm chasing for about 6 years now. It's not exactly the most profitable business, but for me, it's more about it's learning, the excitement of being in front of storms, and then just getting to know more about weather, which has been a fascination of mine for a long time.
So you're like the real life Bill Paxton. What's it like to be inside of the eye of one of these incredible storms?
Being up close and personal to a tornado, it's unreal. It's funny. When I was a child, I used to have dreams of being chased by a tornado. And I think part of this has been overcoming those fears. But being really close to a storm, it's just unreal because you have the rushing wind. As you can see in the video there, it's really hard to explain unless you're there. It's really unreal.
Have you had any close calls in doing this? Have you ever gotten too close to a tornado that was too powerful?
Well, actually, the video you're running there was an EF4 that hit just southwest of Kansas City a couple of days ago. I was really close to that. Luckily, I was able to get out of the way. My first encounter with a tornado back in 2014, there was an EF4 in Arkansas. And if you're not familiar with Arkansas, there's a lot of trees. And I could not even see the tornado until it was right almost directly in front of me, and I had to get out of there. And that was my first tornado experience ever. So I've learned a lot since then. I usually try to keep a good distance so I'm not too close.
Tornadoes occur on every continent, except Antarctica, but more form over the central United States than anywhere else in a zone called Tornado Alley. That's because conditions in the alley are ideal for creating tornadoes. Warm, humid air, low to the ground, moves north from the Gulf of Mexico and collides with cool, dry air high above the ground rolling in from the Rocky Mountains. The collision of air masses creates a supercell, a massive thunderstorm that has a strong, rotating updraft of air. Scientists aren't exactly sure what happens next, but the leading idea goes like this. The difference in speed between the faster high winds and the slower low winds causes the air in between to rotate around a horizontal axis. If one end of the rolling air gets caught in the updraft, it's bent upward and forms a funnel cloud. Its spin gets tighter and faster, and the cloud gets longer. Rain or hail from the thunderstorm can then push down on the tail of the funnel cloud till it reaches the ground, forming a tornado. The top wind speed of most tornadoes is usually under 110 miles an hour, and most are on the ground for less than 10 minutes. However, extreme tornadoes are truly extreme. The longest tornado path was cut by the Tri-State tornado on March 18, 1925. It tore up property for 219 miles, was on the ground for well over 3 hours, and killed 747 people. Which is why I'll be hanging out here in Antarctica with the penguins until tornado season is over. For Scientific American's Instant Egghead, I'm Mark Fischetti.
Almost certainly a significant, strong tornado. Trees have been shredded. Looks like there's some structures. This is US 49. It looks like some homes possibly and structures have been partially damaged with roof damage. This is tornado damage about 3 miles northwest of Seminary, Mississippi.
And the first group I kind of lump into a category of other drivers and then road hazards. So you're driving, you might not necessarily be near a storm, but there's hazards that you encounter on the roadways. And then wildlife was mentioned quite a bit as well. And then the one that might be arguably the most dangerous and the most common is blocking overpasses. It's like an old wives' tale that if you park under an overpass, it is safer to be in that under an overpass with a tornado coming. It's really not true because you can have wind funneling through or channeling through the underpass or through the overpass, debris coming through. But there are two situations in which we see a lot of people just park under overpasses. And unfortunately, if there is a tornado warning or a flood warning on your phone, all of a sudden you'll usually see a lot of drivers just go under an overpass. That's dangerous because you could block oncoming traffic, or if there is a tornado coming, you could block emergency response vehicles, law enforcement, or you could cause just a traffic jam. That could be a nightmarish issue. And then driving too fast with low visibility and heavy rain, but that's a little bit more of a weather-related issue that I may get into more later on. Looking at a screen while driving, and this happens all the time, even from non-storm chasers, people texting on their phones, looking at GPS, going to write a tweet while driving. That is an issue with distracted driving and issues there. And then Ed Sweeney said he had an example where a full-size couch fell off the back of a pickup truck right in front of them while storm chasing. So I haven't had something like that happen to me while storm chasing, but there was one time I was on the freeway and then a grill just flew out of a pickup truck in front of me, and that could have caused a major accident. So things you might have not thought about while storm chasing are couches and grills flying off trucks. And then some people mentioned not being able to find a gas station or a rest stop. And the gas station thing is pretty serious. I'll leave your imagination to the works for the other part of that. But if you're out storm chasing, sometimes there's no gas station for 25, 50, or even more miles. If the nearest gas station is closed, or if the power's out and you're running low on gas, that could be a major issue. And then the other thing that was mentioned quite a bit was wildlife. Deer was the number one issue mentioned. And I can't tell you how many storm chasers I've known who've hit a deer or had a car damaged from deer. Myself, I've had basically 3 instances of having car damage while storm chasing. Only one was weather related and it was minor damage from hail, but I've had a deer total a car, and I've had a deer seriously damage the front end of a car. And I'm not involved just to make money. If anything, it's more of a passion than the money. That's why I make the sacrifice. I drive tens of thousands of miles a year. In 2016, I drove over 90,000 miles. So when I storm chase, I'm all driving. I don't fly. I don't usually carpool. It's just me driving. So on an average year, I probably drive about 50 or 60,000 miles because I will travel all across the country to find storms wherever they are.
Welcome to the Storm Chaser Q Show. I'm meteorologist Quincy Vagell, and today's episode is my most recent storm chase. And this footage is sped up. It's about an hour and 45 minutes long, but it's condensed to show me chasing a long-lived supercell across eastern Colorado. And the camera on my roof of my car is a Sony Action Cam, which features a wide-angle lens. So without further ado, here's the rest of my storm chase.
Slashed and torn. Pressure.